Hey, Foos.
Sup?
Sup?
Chilling. It's episode 224. How's everybody doing today?
Oh, you know, Foo, we mad chilling like a villain.
I'm sorry to hear that. We're sans the Foo for the next few pods, so you can air out your grievances while you can. But
yes.
First, find a bunch of cool Foo Bar Show merch at tpublic.com. Find tons of new merch items like totes, travel mugs, magnets, baseball tees, and regular tees, and tons of new colors and styles. Go to our merch page found at foobarshow.com to check it all out. Also, click on the link to SoCal rock band The Fallen Electric at the bottom of foobarshow.com for music and merch, also through tpublic. Add The Fallen Electric's music to your Spotify or Apple Music playlist today. And lastly, ALF Live Events, man. Whether you'd like to host your next virtual event or you're ready to go live in person or given the times, Foos, in a socially responsible manner. I just get angrier every episode when I say that. Foos, ALF can help you do it right. They pride themselves in being masters of audio, visual, and lighting solutions. And most recently, Foos, they've become masters of virtual events and meetings, partnering with their clients to produce live events in a socially safe environment. Go to alflei.com to get their contact information. They can be contacted via phone call or email for any questions on how they can help you produce a flawless event. That's ALF Live Events at alflei.com. That's alflei.com. Now, without further foos, episode 224, here we go. From Filthy Martini Studios in Ontario, California, it's the Foobar Show!
Hello, what's up everyone? I'm Josh.
Thank y'all very much for listening to the Foobar Show. Thanks for hitting subscribe and remember to rate, review, and tell your friends like a champ. You can always reach us and check out our merch at foobarshow.com. That's foobarshow.com. And search foobarshow on YouTube, Twitch, Twitter, and Instagram. Check us out. Drop us a line and we'll foo it up like a couple of foos. Whatever that means. Ain't that right, foos?
Seafoo.
Yes. Yeah.
On tap today, man, we have just a bunch of stuff to talk about that's going on in the news, specifically with like... Jensen Karp and his Cinnamon Toast Crunch fiasco. We got some Geeking Out. We're skipping Joint Report. There's nothing exciting happening, and I'm pretty high for that one, ironically. We got music highlights, and we have Foo Facts. And also, speaking of music highlights, we were supposed to have Hope on today, Foos. And he flaked. So.
Oh, no. We have no hope. We lost hope.
We lost hope, man. So I guess you could say we're fucked.
Oh no!
Yeah, no. But
2020 continued.
Honestly, I don't know what the hell happened. The only thing I can attribute this to was that he flaked. He gave us some reason that I want to believe.
Scheduling conflict.
I think he flaked. So
just say what it is, man. A spade's a spade.
Well, hey, man, he's not listening. So.
Yeah, that's fine.
Anyway, but I'm sure he'll be on next week. Wink.
Oh yeah. As long as there's no scheduling conflict.
Yeah, sure. but like I said at the beginning of the intro here, fucking, have you heard about this whole thing happening with Cinnamon Toast Crunch, Steph?
Yeah. Yeah, I heard. There's some shrimp tails in the cereal.
Yeah, Kevin and Bean alum, and that's how I really got to know this douchebag. Jensen Karp, he found... like two shrimp tails that were covered and, you know, coated in Cinnamon Toast Crunch.
And what the fuck?
And apparently, you know, he posted this on Twitter and like it became like the number five trending topic on Twitter for like almost immediately, like hours later. And then he sent this to Cinnamon Toast Crunch or General Mills, I guess would be the parent company. And yeah. They totally gaslit him. Like, they said that's the accumulation of, you know, the cinnamon, the sugar that looks like that. And he's like, no, motherfuckers. And then he took another picture and then he put it in his hand. He's like, these are totally shrimp tails. What the fuck is going on over there in General Mills? And then finally, like a few, I don't know, maybe a day or so later, they cop to it. They're just like, yeah, you know, I guess it is. Or I don't know really what came of that. But the subject changed almost immediately because apparently Jensen Karp is known as to his ex-girlfriends as like a pretty brutal abuser, verbal, I guess, a verbal abuser, an emotional abuser. And so like the internet turned on him almost immediately. And I find it pretty funny only because, you know, I didn't hate the guy. Like when he joined the Kevin and Bean show back in, what was it, like 2017? Like immediately after Ralph Garman left or got fired.
Yeah, because he would go on periodically right. In like between 14 and 16. He would be like their hip hop correspondent.
Yeah, he would talk about hip hop beefs or rap beefs too.
Yeah, exactly. And then he eventually took over for Ralph full time. Yeah. And yeah, I mean he was okay. You know,
he wasn't Ralph.
I
mean, that's for sure.
He wasn't Ralph. Mm-mm. And again, that to me, that was just like, wait, so you let go of a great guy like Ralph for this douchebag?
Yeah.
So that was my initial thought when I heard him on, you know, full time.
Well, I'm sure it didn't help that, you know, this is the whenever you fire somebody that people love, people are usually not going to find you appealing at first. And, you know, that
like Steph with Lisa May.
Right.
Oh, man, I was so mad. I listened to Lisa May for a years, yeah. And all of a sudden, Allie came along. Who the fuck is this?
I still love Allie. I think she's hilarious.
Allie's hilarious. Yeah, but, I like.
Look, she's funny, but it's just the wrong time.
Of course, of course. But you know, it's just how it played out, and it wasn't either of their faults. But I wasn't like totally in love with Jensen. I thought he was serviceable. You know, I thought he was like an okay guy to listen to on the radio. I really didn't have much of an opinion of him, I guess, until like a couple days ago when all of this started coming out. And it you know, a lot of people online, specifically the Kevin and Bean Social Club as a group on Facebook, a lot of people just thought he was a douche and came off as a douche on the radio. I guess that radar was not on for me because I just thought he was whatever. But he was no, like, especially when Bean left the Kevin and Bean show and it was just Kevin in the morning with Allie and Jensen. I didn't think he was the greatest to be opposite Kevin because, you know, you can't replace Bean either. So you're shaving off two greats from that are Los Angeles legends on the radio and you're replacing them with a dude like Jensen. And it was, I don't know, he was pretty douchey, man. I don't know.
Yeah, he had a passive aggressiveness to him. It was just kind of like, it's just like, ah, come on, man. Like, you can't have a negative opinion about
everything.
And then the opinions he would have would just kind of be, like, petty. Yeah. Like, really petty, like, opinions about them. It's just like, come on, bro. Like, it ain't that badly. I mean, at least Bean, when Bean was negative, he would have, like, a valid argument and logical argument.
And a lot of jokes to back it up.
Exactly.
A lot of jokes.
Jensen, I feel like Jensen's being a dick and trying to be funny, and he thinks that's his way of being funny.
Yeah.
It didn't blend well, and obviously that's why they're not around anymore.
And you know, I think in a past life for him, before he joined the Kevin and Bean family, I guess you can call it, he was a writer for the WWE.
That's right,
And this is, I guess, the WWE. You can get away with being douchey because, I mean, have you seen those storylines?
Oh, dude, it's a soap opera.
It's a soap opera.
I mean, just watch. It's a soap opera, man. Yeah. I mean, come on. To find out that Stacey McMahon and Triple H were getting married?
Oh, my God.
Blew my mind back in the day.
Okay, it's Stephanie McMahon. Get it right.
Stephanie McMahon. It's been years since I've watched it. Leave me alone. I was enamored when I was a kid. I'm just like, wait, Triple H is eventually going to take over the WWE?
Oh, my God. Well, also, and that's when I discovered that his real name was Hunter Helmsley. I was like, oh, there's initials. I get it now. Mm-hmm. And
the wire is finally connected.
Yeah, I'm like, oh, that's what they call it. You know, you don't question these things. You just take it at face value.
Yeah.
I'm like, okay, that must be. I mean, it must mean something, but I'm not about to look this up. It's not that important to me. But anyway, the one thing that set this all off for the internet to turn on Jensen was that one of his past girlfriends, Melissa Stetton, who is also an actress of her own right, she, or a model actress, which could be referred to as a mattress. What you may not know about the man behind the viral posts,
not to be confused with mattress actress.
Right. What?
It's a porn star.
Ah.
Get out.
Well, what she's saying is that he was a manipulative, gaslighting, narcissistic ex-boyfriend who once told her that he was surprised she hadn't killed herself because her life was so worthless.
Wow, this guy's a piece of shit. You don't say that shit? Come on, man.
Well,
even if
did.
You're thinking it, don't say it.
Well, he did. And I don't know, man. Apparently, she's not the only one. Apparently, also ex-employees of his, if also... You know, one of his other shows that he worked on was Drop the Mic, that rap
the
battle.
CBS.
Yeah, the rap battle
one on
show.
CBS.
So he was a writer on that, and he had a lot of writers on there. Well, not a lot, but like towards the end, they actually had writers. In the first season, they didn't have any writers. And apparently he would just straight up lie to the writers saying, oh, we're not going to use that. And then he later used it. Pretty much he stole their idea, telling him at the time that he wasn't going to use their idea. And he would just gaslight them and just say, no, that never happened.
Dang.
And so, yeah, apparently, like, he's just that kind of guy. Obviously, he's not going to showcase that on shows like the Kevin and Bean show. He's going to try to be opposite Kevin and try to be funny. And even then, it was a hit or miss for him, for me at least. But I don't know. We'll see what happens with all that. Apparently, he's not, like, brought it up or discussed it on social media. He might be forced to at some point, or he's probably just going to hope that it goes away.
Have you guys actually seen the pictures of the Cinnamon Toast Crunch?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've seen it.
So you've seen like the actual squares of the Cinnamon Toast Crunch.
Oh, the actual cinnamon. Yeah, they look like rat droppings.
They
cooked onto the cinnamon.
It really does look like an accumulation of the cinnamon and sugar. But then he takes a picture of like the actual shrimp tails that are supposedly in those squares. And, like, the dimensions don't match up. Like, there's no way that giant shrimp tail could come from a tiny square that looks like that.
Conspiracy.
Well, right.
Someone's asking for attention.
Well, no, what she's saying is that when Cinnamon Toast Crunch was gaslighting him as to, like, you know, they were just saying that it was accumulation of... cinnamon and sugar that's what produced what looks like fishtails. Like, no, dude, they're fishtails. That's for sure. Now if he added them into the cereal himself, that's another story. But
yeah,
there's
like,
no evidence to prove that.
Like, we don't know that.
But there's no evidence to prove he didn't either. So we're just kind of taking everything at face value. But he did show other pictures that look like rat droppings cooked onto the squares. Another one that looks like dental floss. It just looks like he got a bad batch.
Shady Foo, and I'm not talking about the slim one.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, Foos. So let's see. Number one was Hope. He flaked on us. Number two was
no
Hope. Are we leaving anything out of this intro here? I don't think we are. We have quite a bit to talk about in Geeking Out. We got some Winter Soldier and such. You guys want to just get into it?
Yes, sir.
All right, here we go. Geeking Out is brought to us by the new Bandwagon Oscillating Fan. Not a sports fan? Use the Bandwagon Oscillating Fan to blow hot air at the winning team to fit right in.
Hey, Foo, that's your type of fan, huh?
I know. I'm ordering one right now as we speak. anyway, Foos, did you guys get a chance to check out Falcon and Winter Soldier episode duh?
Oh, see, Foo.
It's getting way better. Like, I enjoyed the first episode, which I thought was a great introductory episode to the season. This one, like, it took you like on to the next step of the storyline. They ate in an hour. They fit so much like shit in there. I don't know what you thought, Steph or Josh.
Steph, you go first.
I really like to see the witty banter and the companionship between Falcon and Winter Soldier, because, you know, they've known each other for so long and they actually went to like a therapy session together in this episode. So I thought it was pretty hilarious. And they just started staring at each other.
It was just a staring contest.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely their banter and their chemistry. You could tell their on-screen chemistry is just great because it also reflects off-screen, you know, during their interviews and stuff. It's pretty hilarious seeing them together.
Yeah, and then we got got more of just what was a cheesy introduction to Captain America, Wyatt Russell, his character.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
as John Walker. Mm-hmm. And his partner, Battlestar. I don't know how that's going to play in or how that is relevant because as far as I know, these two new heroes, I guess, don't have powers, right?
Actually, no, that's not true. John Walker actually does have Captain America's strength, speed, and agility because they were able to replicate parts of the super soldier serum. Uh-huh. And that's what you guys are going to find out during this series, because there is a scene also where Bucky goes to see a past Captain America during the 50s, the Korean War. Mm-hmm. Foo, you have his name, correct?
Isaiah Bradley. They go look for him at his home.
Mm-hmm. He is the Black Captain America.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And not too long ago in 2003, Marvel Comics published a comic book series called Truth, Red, White, and Black, a miniseries written by the late Robert Morales and illustrated by Kyle Baker. So this talks about how, like, during or even before World War II, Steve Rogers wasn't the only first or only soldier to undergo that Project Rebirth back then. The U.S. Mm-hmm. government experimented on 300 black soldiers in an attempt to recreate the super soldier serum in 1942. And then what eventually became the super soldier serum was originally intended to cull less desirable bloodlines, sterilizing ethnic groups and people with disabilities. The research later became the basis for the Nazis' eugenics experiments based, you know, in Marvel Comics.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how they explain all that.
Yeah, and I mean, we've already seen some things in past movies about, you know, references to the Super Soldier Serum. Mm-hmm. For instance, way back, one of the original two movies is The Incredible Hulk, mm-hmm. when T-Bolt Rogers pulls out the Super Soldier Serum and tries it on Blonsky, which actually does give him the abilities of Captain America, but his psyche starts to go wrong. And that was one of the problems, is that these soldiers' psyches started to kind of turn on them when they had these abilities, and which may be more in store for John Walker. Because as we see, John Walker's becoming a little darker, at least from what we saw at the first reveal, in the last episode. At the beginning of this episode, we see them open with that cheesy rendition of the Star-Spangled Man, reference to the first Avenger movie. And you think that, okay, maybe this guy is just going to be, you know, Mr. USA, is A-okay. But then as the episode goes on, when he hints at Sam and Bucky who the Flag Smasher is, mm-hmm. and he's just like, if you're not going to work with me, stay out of my way.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Like, that's kind of an opening for what John Walker really is. And he's a dark Captain America. Very dark.
He's not a bad guy, though, right?
No, he's an anti-hero. Yeah. He is definitely one of the epitomes of an anti-hero. He actually doesn't see eye to eye in the comics with Steve Rogers. Mm-hmm. He thinks that he's an old-fashioned Captain America, right, that it's not with the times, and that's what this John Walker is.
Also, I would argue that we even see that difference between how, like, he's kind of like that anti-hero before he says that to Sam and what's his nose. He shoots somebody in the leg.
He pulls out a gun.
Yeah. He pulls out a gun.
Yeah. Yeah, not even Cap would have just thrown his shield automatically, knocked out those three.
Well,
he
didn't have it. Remember, he threw it to help his help his buddy.
Oh, that's right.
On the asphalt, so he didn't have it on him. But what he did have was a gun, which Captain America wouldn't even have a gun on him.
Yeah, and at least not normally. Could tell already, like, yeah, you could tell already John Walker's not afraid to kill someone. Just from the sense that he's willing to just pull out that gun, mm-hmm. and just go. This is a different. You can tell he's going to be a darker Cap. But, yeah, I mean, I can't wait to see what him and Battlestar is in the comics. Mm-hmm. And he has a pretty racy history because originally he was supposed to be a part of like a unit called the BUC, the Buck. Mm-hmm. And so in the like 60s, when he was being published, a lot of the writers went up to the main writer or Marvel, and they're like, you guys got to change that term, Buck. Like, we can't call them Buckies or Bucks, mm-hmm. because of the racial connotations of the word Buck, which was used during like for Mandingos or slaves, yeah. you know, the black slaves. Like, mm-hmm. that's a nice buck. Mm-hmm. So that's why they changed his name to Battlestar. And he's actually fought against U.S. agent, a.k.a. John Walker, in the comics. Like, they were actually rivals. They weren't partners. So they're already kind of putting on a different spin to this Battlestar. It's still the same character, I think, or the same origin. Yeah. Or alias, I'm sorry. Lucas, I think, is his name. Or I can't recall his name in the show right now. But, it's...
Lamar Hoskins.
Lamar Hoskins. There you go. Yeah, it's... Yeah, this series already looks like it's ramping up quickly, much faster than WandaVision. Yeah. Granted, there's a less episodes in this one. I think it's only 6 as opposed to the 9 we received.
And are we supposed to be getting more than just the one season? What have you heard on that?
Yes, so for Winter Soldier, Falcon and Winter Soldier, this one, this is an actual series. Like, mm-hmm. they're planning multiple seasons to this for this particular series.
Right.
So it's not just a one-off like WandaVision, mm-hmm. Because they're not going to have any Captain America movies anymore. It's just going to be this Falcon and Winter Soldier series continuing Captain America's story.
Yeah. Well, he's gone, or at least he's old, he's aged, he's retired by now.
He's retired. Yeah. Yeah. And that's what I think that's the better way to go, especially with the Captain America series, because it really led itself to an espionage, mm-hmm. Type of setting. So, and I think those are much more successful than anything else because, everyone loves a procedural cop show or like a buddy cop show.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Well, going back over to Isaiah Bradley, I wanted to talk about how, like, you know, he was part of that super soldier serum experiment that took place in the 40s that they haven't been able to recreate it perfectly, I guess, because there's other side effects. But following the death of his squad mates, who also survived the experiments and body horror that came with them, Isaiah Bradley became the government's weapon, facing all the obstacles but receiving none of the glory that Steve Rogers received. And when the government was done with Bradley, they imprisoned him for 17 years for stealing Captain America's uniform. They sterilized him and harvested his sperm and blood for further experiments, while denying him the treatment required for the side effects of the serum, leaving him with mental capabilities of a child when he was eventually pardoned in the 70s. So... this is an article actually that I found on the Hollywood Reporter. I thought they did a great job in kind of summarizing this character that he played a big role in the episode. I think that this was probably the most in your face hint that there was, you know, racism happening throughout the mid portion of the last century. But the little bits of other racism that you see, did you notice how, like, when the cops pulled up, they immediately asked Sam for his information rather than Bucky?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then Bucky's still not understanding the dynamic between a black man and policemen. And just telling him, hey, man, just show him your ID. Like, no, dude, like, I shouldn't have to do this. Like, what the fuck? Do you not know who I am? Kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Also, I think Sam is too humble to use that phrase, you know who I am, but the motherfucker, like, saves him from Thanos, dude. Right.
Yeah.
Also, considering he can't get a loan these days.
Right? It's like he gets known for being an Avenger, he can't get a loan. Mm-hmm. He doesn't get known for being an Avenger, fucking gets pulled over by the fucking cops and interrogated.
Just because he was arguing with Bucky in the middle of the street.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's just like, yeah, I like that. That was good. That was really
subtle,
really,
but it was like, yeah, everybody understood what was happening here.
Mm-hmm. And then seeing in the neighborhood, seeing a white guy getting pulled away instead of a black guy.
Yeah.
I think that's another powerful statement, too. It's just like, you know, that's why they're like, oh, what the hell? Now they're not going to take the black. Now they're going to take the white guy.
Right.
Win.
Well, not only
at least that's what the neighborhood's thinking.
Right. When they were talking to Isaiah, he says, like, you know, he pretty much was a hero. And what did the government do? They locked him away for 30 years.
Mm-hmm. And you also notice how he has aged more significantly than Bucky has. You know, this was, I guess, because maybe he was a super soldier, maybe a significant amount of years before Bucky even got it. Who knows?
Well, that has no, actually, that's actually interesting that you bring that up, because there are references to why Bucky and Steve look so young, because Bucky was constantly cryogenically frozen through the years. Remember, Hydra would always put him on ice after using him. So that's why Bucky still looks young. Otherwise, if Bucky was never put on ice, he would probably look the same as Isaiah. If you think about it,
that's true. Okay, I forgot about that detail.
Yeah, it's forgettable. I mean, at this point, we've already... That was like years ago when we all saw that stuff. And there haven't been many references to the fact that he's been cryogenically frozen.
Yeah.
No, but yeah, it's... Oh, man. So I can't wait.
I think that, you know, his grandson who opened the door and wouldn't let him in at first? That is the introduction to his grandson, Elijah Bradley, who also is some kind of superhero in the Marvel comics as well. So we're probably going to see a lot more of him a lot later on when they start to introduce the new Avengers. I forget what he's called. Is he the Patriot?
Or who is he? Yes.
You know? Yeah.
Yes, I believe he is the Patriot. And they're introducing the young Avengers pretty much in these series, because we've already seen Speed and Wiccan, you know, in WandaVision. So and we'll Spectrum. Expect to see them more.
We got Spectrum in there. Spectrum.
Oh, yeah, she's Spectrum,
not in
yes.
I don't think she's going to be in the Young Avengers.
Oh, okay. No, the Young Avengers are made up of the kids. So
think
you
Teen
got,
Titans.
Yeah, they're like the Teen Avengers, exactly. So you're going to see... yeah, Wiccan, Speed. Now you're going to see the Patriot, I believe is Elijah Whitley's name. I'll look that up. And then you're going to see Hawkeye, the new Hawkeye in the upcoming Hawkeye series, played by Hailee Steinfeld, a.k.a. Kate Bishop. She's going to be the new Hawkeye. And then in the Quantum Manium, the Ant-Man and Wasp movie, they're going to introduce, what's her name? Scott Lang's daughter. She's going to be like an Ant-Man type of... I can't remember her character name, though.
Good ol' who's it?
She's actually played by the actress from Supernatural. That was Cass's daughter.
Casey.
That ended up being...
Cassie?
Cassie, yes.
All right.
Yes.
Yes. Yes, Foo. They're setting him up pretty nicely, and... I can't wait to see, because I think they're also going to include Spider-Man in that. I think that's going to be one of their team-up movies. Because remember, they're allowed at least one more Spider-Man solo movie, and then the rest, I think at least three more team-up movies where they can use him in Marvel.
Which
and
I think it's enough. I think they could tell a good story with that. I mean, there's nothing to say that they're not going to renew their contracts, but for now, I think that'll give a pretty decent storyline.
Cassie Lang. Steph,
what do you got?
Cassie Lang is going to be called Stinger. That's her name.
Because she's a stinger.
Oh, Jesus.
In the Young Avengers. Stinger.
All right. Cool, cool. Well, Foos, speaking about Sebastian Stan, you know, he collects a paycheck from Disney right now. And I don't see why he wouldn't be able to cross over to the Star Wars universe, because everybody's calling for him to be a young Luke Skywalker. And I don't disagree, because the motherfucker looks just like Mark Hamill when he was younger. He might have a more like prominent jawline or a wider jawline, but he looks like Luke Skywalker, man. I don't know if you've seen those like comparison side by side pictures.
Oh, dude, totally. I honestly thought he was going to be the Luke Skywalker in that scene. There were people putting up like, oh, Sebastian Stan is a young Luke Skywalker. Yeah. And I'm just like, God damn, that looks spot on.
Yeah, it does. I think he would just be way buffer, though. You know what I mean? Because I don't remember Mark Hamill being buff when he was Luke Skywalker back in the early 80s.
No, he wasn't.
The closest was like in Empire when he was like working out.
Yeah.
Like, but when he was in his black suit. Buff. He was just kind of like
fit. He was fit.
Yeah, he was
like
fit,
athletic.
He,
yeah, I would yeah, say. Yeah,
yeah. But I think Sebastian Stan finally responded and said, "Look, Disney has not talked to me about playing this character." And he's like, "And I would only do it with the consent of Mark Hamill."
Like, yeah, he was talking to Good Morning America, and he's just like, "If Mark Hamill called me personally to tell me he feels inclined to share this role with me, then I will believe it. Until then, I won't believe it." And this is when, you know, people chattering about, you know, he should be the young Luke Skywalker if there ever, if there's going to be one in, you know, Mandalorian, because we already saw a preview of that, which was nice. But they could have, instead of using the CGI, they could have easily just put him on, the, you know, gave him the robe and told him to take off with it.
Just, yeah, just take over. And I mean, who's to say that it's not possible? Because I do recall that when fans had brought this up to Hamill himself, he would say, you know, I wouldn't share this role with a lot of people, but he's like, but dang, you guys are really convincing me on this one. Cause he's like, he's like long lost son. And like, he said this in like other things, like a couple of years ago, like him and, cause Stan and Hamill actually have somewhat of a relationship. Like they've spoken friendly, like they're friendly with one another. So come on, Hamill, man, just give him the role. Let him do it. He will do you justice.
He still wants to crunch a paycheck though, bro. Like, you can't take that away from Luke Skywalker.
I know, man. But
yeah, you're
such a hard thing to do.
He doesn't look the way he used to, and man, Sebastian Stan looks very much like him. I mean, even I would be okay with Luke Skywalker having a 5 o'clock shadow if Sebastian Stan was in it. So,
yep.
Anywho,
yeah.
Last but not least, unless you guys had anything else to talk about, but I wanted to shit on you guys, you and the Foo, because of, you know how Steph and I have been complaining for the last few weeks about not complaining. I don't want to call it complaining.
Oh, you've been complaining.
Don't sugarcoat it.
What we've been doing is we've been pointing out how slowly this last final season of Attack on Titan is taking to actually get some answers. According to you guys, you know, they're following the manga, which I can respect. And that only tells me that the manga is moving pretty slowly. So
it's only like one issue a month.
All right. You know, well, try this on for size. How about the second part of the final season announced to take place at the tail end of 2022? What do you guys say about that?
Son of a bitch, Foo. That's what I got to say, man. Son of a bitch.
Now, this is just telling me that it's going to, like, they better answer some fucking questions in the second part, because while I will say they've been answering a lot of questions in regards to what has happened during the time jump between season 3 and season 4 of Attack on Titan, they're doing it
and giving you a history of the whole
thing. Yeah, but they're doing it in a very conversational way. Like, I would much more prefer like some flashbacks. Like, give me a fucking flashback of when that fucking happened.
That's all they've been doing this season. It's a fucking flashback for every single
But for
fucking...
like the battle scenes too, not just an explanation of what was going on, cuz man, that's a bit of a snore fest, man.
Like, which battle scenes are you referring to?
All of them.
I don't understand, Foo. They haven't been referencing many battles. Okay.
Just one more action, okay, bro. Just blow more shit up. I need Aaron Yeager to start tearing more shit up rather than just the one and a half episode that we got.
Okay, so here's my response to your bitching over there, Foo. see, this arc in the manga, like, this is exactly how it plays out. Like, even when reading it, a lot of it's just drawn out for most of the manga chapters. Like, we really, like, I think when me and the Foo were reading it, we didn't really get any action for like 6 months in the manga. Like, it was just nothing but exposition, which is what we're seeing now, and history, and, you know, some you know, backstory as to the founder of Ymir, you know, what everything actually means, where everything came from, which is what we're seeing right now in the season. And this next episode tonight, tonight is the last episode that they're going to be premiering, which, you know, until 2020.
Until another year and a half, Josh.
Fucking bullshit, goddammit.
Year
but they
and
had,
a half, Josh.
They had.
They better.
Foo, you don't have.
You know what? They better have the original animation. Shut up, Josh.
No, it's they're not. They already announced that MAPPA's coming back and finishing off the series.
They
so
may
we're
improve
done.
The theme
that animation's
song.
Gone.
That's it. That's
they may fun. Improve the theme song. Is that while I've gotten
here's
to
open foo.
I've gotten used to, I'm not going to say I would like it, but I've gotten used to the current theme song, both intro and outro, but they're nowhere near as triumphant as season one and two.
No, season one and two are just right in your face, get you hyped up for the fucking episode. Even when it was slow at the beginning,
yeah.
Like when you heard it, you're like, oh my God, what am I getting into? Just like in the back of your seat, like, what is happening? But now it's just kind of like you feel a little emotional before you watch it. Like, why are you filling me up with emotions? I don't want emotions.
But so much for getting answers to this fucking series. We got to wait another fucking year and a half, Josh. And this is what I got to
well,
say to
tonight,
you in the
boo. Oh, frankly, you no.
boo tonight.
Liars? You are fucking liars.
Tonight you're going to get a cliffhanger. It's obviously there's going to be a cliffhanger.
Typical.
But you're going to finally see what Aaron's endgame is because he's about to flip it on everyone's head going forward. Like this is the first time in like in anime where the character you thought you were supposed to root for and you thought was the hero during the series. Mm-hmm. Nope. He's been the villain all along.
Well, and we kind of saw that in the last one when he beat the shit out of Armin.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I mean. And then tonight is when it's going to solidify because you're really going to find out what his... Because he doesn't... Like, what you guys saw, what Zeke thinks is going to happen, which mm-hmm. we saw in the last episode, was the euthanization of all Eldians. That's not what Aaron actually wants. Mm-hmm. And spoiler alert, Aaron's going to start the Rumble. Mm. And that's what we're probably going to be seeing tonight. Not the actual like beginning, seeing them walk, but you're going to see Aaron finally bring all of this together. And people are just going to be like, what the fuck? Like all of the Eldians are going to be like, we thought you were our hero. And it's going to just be a big slap in the face. Like, fuck all y'all. Like, I'm here for revenge. And I'm upset that they're going to fucking extend it again. And I'm cussing a lot right now because it's fucking bullshit. Like, come on, goddammit. You're pulling a Game of Thrones thing on all of us. And I know this ending's going to be satisfied, but you're...
Final.
Goddammit.
Final.
Ah, hell, did I think that crap?
Fucking Josh, dude.
Final.
Yeah, well, you know, I'm actually... Well, it gives me something to look forward to. You know, I guess. When is it? Like the tail end of 2022? Do you know?
2023.
No. What specifically the month?
It's going to be in January of 20. Because their winter in Japan.
Oh,
is
it's January.
Yeah.
Oh, so the. Yeah,
yeah.
So
it's
the fall,
like
okay, so it's not
it's
a year.
It's
going to
be like January. No. It's going to be like
months.
January, February.
Okay.
So we probably. Yeah, most likely it's. It's fucking upsetting still, though. And I think the reason why they're doing this is because the manga, the final chapter hasn't released in the manga. Mm-hmm. It's releasing in a week. We're going to get the final chapter. And I think they're going to, well, I hope they animate this entire last 30 chapters into movies or, you know, if they are going to continue it as a season. I hope they do it justice because what you read in the manga, and I suggest everyone just read it because mm-hmm. it's still cool and it's still visually striking. Like you, when I read these, I always think of the actors or use the voices from like the anime.
Yeah.
Like I hear the voices of the anime in my head as I read them, and it's good. It's cool, man. But if you're not satisfied with what's going on in the season, just fucking pick up a goddamn laptop and read people.
Yeah, I may do something like that. I don't know. I'm thinking about it. But I don't know, man. You just mentioned that Aaron Yeager was turning on us. You know, we thought he was the hero of this whole series. What's to say he doesn't turn back and actually does become the hero in the manga?
Nope.
You don't think he's gone too far off the deep end, do you think, by now?
From what we already witnessed in the manga, and I've purposely have not said anything because it's major spoilers, mm-hmm. It's physically impossible.
Or is it?
No, it's physically impossible.
Or... is it?
I could spoil this for everyone and upset everyone in the process right now.
It's all a dream.
No. Okay. Fine. Fine. Spoiler. Here we go.
No,
spoiler.
No.
Spoiler.
No.
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 No. No. No.
Nope. Nope. Nope.
See? Well, then shut the fuck up and just wait.
Stop making this hard, dude.
Oh, for fuck's sake, Foo. All right. I guess I can wait. But I'm not happy about it.
No, you won't be. But you'll just read, Foo. Just read the manga. You'll be satisfied.
Okay, okay.
You'll get all your answers.
He won't.
He will, though.
Well, we don't have a joint report today. Is that we're just going to go straight on into sports after this, but do you guys have anything else you want to touch on?
Yeah, last thing is the Suicide Squad trailer.
Oh, shit, that's right.
Yeah, Foo, just glossing over the important things and such.
Yeah.
It actually looks pretty great.
I like it. It has that James Gunn kind of humor to it, for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think they did the humor right this time, and they finally got the tone of what the Suicide Squad is. Foo, we finally found out who's playing King Shark.
Yeah.
None other than Slash Stone.
Yeah, that's right.
Cut me, Mick. Yeah, man. Cut me.
King Shark. He's a shark.
He's the hand. That was pretty funny scenes, man.
You know what, man?
It looks good.
Yeah. I'm still gonna say that I would prefer Ron Funches to remain as King Shark, but I'm okay with Stallone doing it.
That's a different King Shark.
You know what, Foo? Ron Funches is perfect in the Harley Quinn series. Yeah. He is King Shark, and yeah, I mean I'm okay with him staying on there, but I don't mind having King Shark being a big dumb lug, because I mean. Yeah. That's what he is, man. He's just a giant shark that really doesn't have a brain anymore. He just mutated. So it's pretty cool. And then Foo, I don't know if you noticed, one of our favorite actors who's been in multiple comic series and shows, Mr. David Dasmalchian, who's playing Polka Dot Man.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, man. He actually was recently on The Flash as Abracadabra.
Oh, really?
This last week. Which is pretty cool. I recommend everyone catch up on The Flash again.
So what? He was good in that. What's the polka dot's powers or whatever? What does he do?
So I'll look that up, because honestly, I vaguely remember him in Batman episodes, uh-huh. But they were always like cheesy. But I'll look that up. But I love the scene he had with Idris Elba, where Idris Elba's like, "We're all gonna die," and he's just like, "I hope so." It's like, oh, for fuck's sake.
Yeah, the Red Band trailer is pretty funny. And, you know, Harley Quinn, to me, ever since she first came out in the Batman animated series, to me, I always thought that she was a comic relief. Whereas in the last couple of Harley Quinn movies or movies that feature her, they want to, like, create a sex symbol out of her. But that's not what she is. She's just a witty, funny chick who can kick everybody's ass that also happens to have dated the Joker.
Mm-hmm.
I don't.
She's a badass rebel chick.
Yeah.
I don't get your thinking with her trying to be a sex symbol. I don't get that from her.
From those first two movies where it was the first Suicide Squad and Harley Quinn?
I think.
You didn't get that? Like, there were all kinds of scenes where they were trying to, like, show off, you know, her.
I think that was mostly Suicide Squad.
Yeah, and her evolution as a character has gone away from that.
Yeah, in Harley Quinn and the Fantabulous and the Birds of Prey, yeah. It definitely did move away from that sex object mm-hmm. that they did in the first Suicide Squad.
Yeah,
like, I mean, where you see her dancing on the table in front of Joker.
Well, that was
is that what you're alluding to, Foo?
That of course,
Joker,
all that
pulling the strings there.
Yeah, but I don't know that Joker would even make her, like, do that, you know, in front of everybody like that. It doesn't seem like something Joker, I mean, I guess that he could, but that's not the Joker we know. I mean, that's what also ended up me not liking the Jared Leto Joker. He was just a
Yeah, because, I mean, the Joker in the comics, he wasn't like that. He didn't force her to do it, but he would, manipulate her.
Yeah.
He would mentally manipulate her into doing little things, and she in her mind thinks that that's what he wants. And again, you guys are going more into this psychologically than it needs to be. But yes, Foo, I think your point that they were trying to make her a sex symbol initially, considering it was Margot Robbie, who's pretty, you know, not easy on the eyes, if you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I think they definitely have moved away from that, because she didn't really get, like, at the beginning of Birds of Prey, they really tried to had her like still in that sex symbol kind of phase, but then she moved away from that in the movie. Like, again, it was her metamorphosis. Yeah.
But we're actually going to see her be funny in this one.
Mm-hmm. So that's, and still a badass.
Yeah. That's going to be cool.
Yeah, and then so the polka dot man, his abilities, he wore a costume in spots, which being different sizes and colors were not actual polka dots. Once they're removed from the costume, the spots could be used for a variety of purposes, such as creating deadly weapons, a bizarre escape vehicle. He succeeded in capturing Robin, but Batman defeated him. But yeah, pretty much these polka dots can even be like, you know how like in cartoons when you'd put a big hole on the wall and they can walk through it?
That's
yeah.
exactly it's what like, I was thinking of.
That's exactly what he does. Like, he does, like, he uses these polka dots in a variety of ways.
All right.
So it's going to be interesting to see how they go. They talk about his backstory.
They're probably not. He's going to be probably one of the ones that dies first.
Probably.
He'll use one polka dot.
He used one and then he dies. So that they don't have to do all the CGI.
I think the one that's going to die first or early is Pete Davidson's character or Fleur LeBorg.
I think
like one of those two will die.
Isn't that what he said was going to happen? He's like, I don't last too long in this movie at some point in like an interview.
Yeah. I think he's going to be this because remember in the first one, wasn't it Slipknot? He was the one that died early on. Like, he tried getting away and they blew up his brain.
He's like, fuck this. So I don't buy any of this.
Yeah.
And then he blew him up.
Yeah. Yeah, so, yeah, man, I'm excited to see it. I like Peacekeeper, John Cena. Though you can't really see him, Foo. Like, you only see a floating helmet. Right. It's weird.
Yeah.
It's weird.
Dumb.
Yeah.
Dumb.
I mean, Foo, he wants to eat a beach full of dicks, man. He's willing to eat a beach full of dicks if it means his liberty. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what boy bad people do bad things. Like, yeah, dude, it's...
I heard that they're even considering giving him a show now or giving him a project because he's just so good in this movie.
Oh, yeah. They confirmed there is a Peacekeeper series that will be releasing, I think, like a month before Suicide Squad on HBO Max. It's going to be called Peacekeeper. And it's pretty much like him in front of camera, like doing like studio stuff or like going out and like doing weird things as Peacekeeper, and it's supposed to tell the story of him, how he eventually joins the Suicide Squad. All
right.
So yeah, I can't wait for that to come out. Yeah, man, we got a lot of movies coming out soon too, because we got Godzilla versus Kong this upcoming Wednesday.
Right, the 31st.
I'm so excited for that, Foo. It's going to be showing in theaters as well as on HBO Max. Mm-hmm. So, and you don't got to pay for it unless you have an HBO Max. If you don't have an HBO Max subscription, then pay it up.
Yeah, I have my ways.
We have HBO.
I know you do, Foo.
Yeah, I'll watch it. Yes. Trust me, we'll watch it.
Can't stop me.
Can't stop me. Hey, man, $30 saved is $30 earned, if you ask me. I don't know.
That's true, Foo. That is true. I'll give you that. Damn, Foo. Another word of wisdom from Foo C.
Yes, sir. All right, man. Well, I think that's going to do it for Geeking Out. Everybody stick around for sports.
Nerd!
FUBAR Sports is brought to us by Interception, the new Plan B pill brought to us by the NFL.
Oh, it can't be overturned then, huh?
Sir.
Intercept.
Damn it.
It's like contraception, but it's interception.
Well, that one's on purpose, Foo.
Okay, gotcha.
Well, Foo,
what's going on?
Sports?
We haven't had sports in a while, man.
We haven't, Foo. I purposely let it breathe because, you know, we're just in that lull period where not many major things are going on, Foo, but we just had March Madness kick off last weekend.
Right.
And it was just led with nothing but disappointment for all the bettors out there in the world because zero brackets survived week one, man.
That's crazy. Has that ever happened? Probably, right?
No.
No?
No. This is the first time the favorites were just wiped out in week one. Like, dang. No one predicted was able to predict that the underdogs would just sweep out right now. And it's amazing. Like, number one, Iowa, they were actually touted to be one of the finalists in you know, in the series, and they lost to Oral Roberts. Hmm. Oral Roberts, Foo.
Who's that?
That's exactly Foo. Oh, okay. Exactly.
Who?
Huh?
Exactly. And then we had none other than Loyola Marymount of Chicago. Loyola Chicago, Foo, just all, you know, beating number one seed Illinois, and they trounced them, Foo. Sister Jean fucking prayed to the Lord that they would win, Foo, and they sure did.
This is a regular who's who?
Exactly, Foo. That's exactly what it is, because I have no idea. Yeah. I didn't know any of these schools existed, to be quite frank, until this all happened.
Well, this is what they all pray that happens, because, you know, there's all these like schools in like really rural places, or they're not like big Cal States, for example, and their only real claim to fame would be these football games, especially during March. It's the only time mm-hmm. to get highlighted ever.
Yeah, man, exactly. And I think obviously that's the appeal to March Madness, is that any random school, if you just give them the chance to go up against these top five, you know, blue blood schools, has a chance. And I mean, obviously we see that this year for sure. We've also seen the reemergence of Michigan under new head coach Juwan Howard, former NBA champion with the Miami Heat, one time All-Star. You got to give the dude his due when you at least make one All-Star. You got to count it. You got to say it, Foo. You got to say it. I mean, but this is the first time Michigan's been like legit since Chris Webber, Jalen Rose, Juwan Howard himself went, since the Fab Five went there, and led to the school to a couple of back-to-back champions. And it's pretty cool to see them, be good again. But yeah, man, I was laughing my ass off when I found out all these people were just, you know, people were posting like, this is bullshit. God damn it. I can't, how the hell does Oral Roberts beats Iowa? And Iowa had this badass player, Luca Garza, who was like the best player in the NCAA, and they just wiped him out. It's just like, dude, it was like nothing.
Like, what was the score, though? Do you remember?
I'm trying to find them right now. Just kind of throwing me everywhere. But I'll tell you momentarily. So stay tuned for that. But one score I can say. So let's see here. NCAA basketball. Yeah, they're mostly only playing on like Saturdays and Sundays. But let's mm-hmm. see, on the 17th.
Are there any people in the stands for this?
Some of them do. Yeah, some state, depending on the state ordinances, some have been allowed to be in the stands. Mm-hmm. I think like Indiana and all that have been allowed. Even Texas, since Texas is fucking wide open now.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm. So here are some of the scores from week one. So Loyola Chicago, number 8 seed, beat number 1 seed Illinois, 71. Loyola Chicago, Illinois, 58.
Wow.
And then the next upset we have here is number 11 Syracuse, 75 over number 3 West Virginia, 72. So that one was a pretty close one. That actually, I think, mm-hmm. came down to the wire. And then the next upset on here was, Oral Roberts beat Florida. So number 15, Oral Roberts beat number 7, Florida, 81-78.
Oh, that's pretty close.
That was actually a pretty close one. And then number 12, Oregon State, good old Pac-12, Foo, beat number 4, Oklahoma State, 80-70. Mm-hmm. Beat them by 10. Mm-hmm. And from what I was watching on the highlights over that weekend, wasn't that close. the score does not dictate how close this game really was, because it was not close. And actually, number 2 Iowa lost to number 7 Oregon, 95-80.
Huh.
Oh, wow.
So, all right. I know how I'm going to come off here, but, you know, I'm a guy who doesn't normally watch sports, specifically those that aren't in the pro level. But what is the appeal to college sports? Is it the betting?
It pretty much is the betting. And then it's the main appeal is you're seeing this young talent emerge mm-hmm. and eventually go into the, you know, NBA. So it's there's three factors actually for college sports. I like to think one is you love the school, or you're either an alumni or you just grew up liking the school. Mm-hmm. So you just follow the team.
Like a lot of USC t-shirts out there.
Most USC people, like for instance, my father was a USC fan, never went to college, but he was just always a fan of the. Of the sports, like football, because they always had champion. They had championships a lot. You've gone to the championship a lot in like the 70s and 80s.
Yeah, they were on a rampage for blocks of time.
Yeah, and they had top talent come out of that school, like Marcus Allen, Ronnie Lott, O.J. Simpson.
Mm-hmm. That's your favorite.
Hey, Foo. Hey, let's not hate now.
The juice.
What?
The juice.
The juice, Foo. Everyone likes to juice it up.
That's right.
You don't like your OJ, then you crazy.
Then you die.
yeah, and then the other thing too is the betting. You know, being able to bet on the unpredictability of these sports, because yeah, you still have kids that are still technically kids out of high school. Not all of them have fully developed. So there is going to be some, you know, like high school-esque type of plays, but mm-hmm. the majority of it are like high level plays at an early age. And three, Foo, it's the rivalries, man. It's just the history behind these schools and like the sports. That's really those are the three key appeals. You know, obviously if you're a big, you know, fan of any of these sports, if you're just a basketball purist mm-hmm. or a football purist, obviously that's another reason. But those are more of like the outliers. Because you don't have many people that are just like full-on purists. Now, you know, everyone likes to dabble and,
right.
you know, little things here and there.
So much on TV these days.
What do you mean? Yeah. It's what's on TV, Foo. It's what's on TV.
Oh, whatever, man.
Yeah, Foo. So, I mean, again, it's just been a crazy March Madness. And there's still some more craziness left to come. Again... Let me go into another. There were another couple of upsets this last weekend. So let's look at number. So number 12, Oregon State, actually came back and beat Loyola Chicago. So Sister Jean's no longer in the tournament, Foo. She's going to have to sit her ass at home.
All right.
Sorry, Sister Jean. And then our Cinderella story, Oral Roberts, lost to Arkansas. So... Sorry, Foo. A lot of the big heavyweights are starting to come back. Like Houston came number two. Houston beat Syracuse 62-46. So Syracuse got humbled real quick after that nice little victory they had last week. Because we're in the Sweet 16, and we're starting to get the teams to round out the Elite Eight, which is the second to last. Or no, I'm sorry, third to last round before the final. Because we got Elite Eight, Final Four, and then Championship. Uh-huh. So we still have some more games left, but we'll see where we're at next week, Foo, and how many more brackets. Well, obviously there's no brackets left, so let's see what other upsets are going to be coming up.
So fuck it.
Fuck it. Just watch it. Enjoy the chaos, Foo, because that's all March Madness is chaos.
Yeah.
It's just pure chaos.
Okay. All right. Well, I'll check in with you next week when I can pretend to care again about that.
See, Foo, that's all I ask, Foo. Just a little pretend. Just play along.
Right. What else is going on in sports?
Anything Foo, else? The Dodgers will have opening season, Foo. We'll finally have in baseball come back this next week.
And they're going to allow a limited amount of people in the stadium?
See, Foo, they're going to allow, I think, a minimum of 10,000 fans, mm-hmm. Obviously spread out throughout Dodger Stadium.
Yeah.
But Gavin Newsom did say that as long since the vaccination numbers are looking better, he will start to allow fans to attend certain sporting events.
I think that you should get a vaccine with a ticket since they're doing it there at Dodger Stadium.
I mean, Foo, that's just, you know, that's just practical in my opinion. That's efficiency.
Or free ticket with full vaccination.
Well, there's that. Yeah.
But wait, you don't have to pay for the vaccination.
That's why both are free.
Whoa.
It's a win-win.
But a hot dog will be like $30.
Yeah.
No, son of a... No, they're going to raise it up to 40 just to cover their losses.
Yeah. For the last year and this one.
And a beer is going to be 30.
There's a golden opportunity.
Now, well, I heard that there was going to be that the stands were going to be closed for a lot of these professional games, whatever sport it's going to be. But they're going to be guys like, you know, like you get your hot dog, you know, kind of walking around. You're going to get way more of that.
Yeah, I think they're going to be closing off or cordoning off like the first row. Mm. Like the first row of seats, like they're not like it. I don't know if you've seen any NBA games recently where they pretty much have like the first 10 seats covered with tarps. Uh-huh, yeah. And then after that, that's when you kind of see a sprinkling of some fans, and then more as you get to the top, right. Like they're a little bit more sprinkled out. So I think that's essentially what we're going to see for like baseball, especially since a lot of these stadiums are outdoors. So, you know, they're not in any enclosed space. NBA, I still don't think they're going to allow fans. Because you're in that enclosed arena, you know, there's still a little higher risk. Well, actually, I'm sorry. Some NBA teams have, depending on state ordinances, but I don't think California is going to be allowing that anytime soon. Mm-hmm. But Foo, yeah, so April 1st, Foo. It's not an April Foo's joke either. The Dodgers will be playing at 1:10 against the Colorado Rockies, and we will assert our dominance once again.
Really? You think that early on in the season?
I mean, Foo, it's the Rockies. It's an easy win. It's
They were really good really recently too.
Yeah.
I mean, they started letting all their players go, and then I mean, Foo, someone's got to take the place of the Padres since the Padres are doing good all of a sudden. So yeah. Now and the Giants are kind of on their way up again. Mm-hmm. So that's why now the D-bags and the Rockies. Are kind of, you know, shitty again. You know, it has to balance out, Foo. When you have two teams go up, two teams go down.
That's true.
I mean, it's equivalence. Well, it's the law of equivalent exchange, Foo.
And the latest trades, it's just opened up the fucking the whirlwind of just like anything can happen now with all these trades that happened over the offseason.
Foo, all these sports trades in general are just insane when you really think about like the way these transactions move and like now all of a sudden we have a powerhouse in San Diego. San Diego's a powerhouse now? What the fuck, man?
Yeah.
I thought we were cool, bro. I thought we had an agreement. Like we'll let you have a little taste of the top every once in a while during the regular season, mm-hmm. But playoff time, no, man. It's our seat. That's our seat.
I just hate Machado so much.
Oh, dude.
I hate him.
After that World Series, I will never like him ever. Yeah.
He's such a douche.
He is, man. Yeah. He really is. Too. And I can't wait to see the Dodgers trounce them this year because we will have our justice. But right. Anyways, moving on to some NBA action. Mm-hmm. Lakers have been hobbling, Foo. We've been humbled these last couple of weeks.
Yeah.
With the loss of Anthony Davis. He's been out with a severe calf strain. And Achilles strain. So they've been kind of easing him in back into regular shape in the season. He may come back in like the next 3 weeks. Thank God. But LeBron's been out. And LeBron is actually out indefinitely. So we may not see him until the playoff time.
What was his deal again? Why is he out?
So he has a high ankle sprain. And that happened against the Hawks. And that was it didn't look pretty because what happened was he was the ball handler, mm-hmm. And all of a sudden he lost the ball and was going after it. And as he was going out or reaching out for the ball, Solomon Hill went into his leg, and you could see his leg kind of bend weird, mm-hmm. Like just in an awkward way because he caught his ankle as it was bending. So like he immediately pulled it, and he was just like screaming in pain. Mm-hmm. And then he played like one play, and then he had to walk off. And the dude was pissed, throwing chairs on his way out. I mean, bro, we don't got to throw chairs, man. We're all just trying to be cool here.
That guy's pissed.
He's pissed, man. He's pissed. Yeah. He's pissed, I tells you. So you know what the Lakers did, Foo? They said, LeBron, they killed him. Don't worry.
Oh.
We got you. No, Foo, no. You got to mend the horse, Foo. You don't just bust out the shotgun all of a sudden.
I mean, I grew up on the wrong farm then.
Yeah, you did. Breaking chicken heads, necks off, and such.
Chipped a nail, time to put him down.
Mm-hmm. I know what you did, blah. Foo, the Lakers signed Andre Drummond today. He was actually bought out by the Cleveland Cavaliers, who bought out the remainder of his contract. And so he's technically a free agent. And he intends to sign with the LA Lakers after he claims he's clearing waivers. So meaning that the Lakers are going to pretty much pay him like $900,000 for the remainder of the year to play for them. And then potentially could re-sign him. But dude, this guy averages like 18 rebounds a game. He's a great defensive player, so he's definitely what the Lakers need, and he's young. He's only like 20, 27, 28.
Why would Cleveland let him go?
Well, he had a pretty big contract because he originally was on the Detroit Pistons. Mm-hmm. And when he was up to sign his new contract, he signed a like 4-year, $185 million deal with them. And then they traded him last year to the Cleveland Cavaliers. And the Cavs are in no way in playoff contention. Mm-hmm. So usually like around this time, like the trade deadline just passed. And whenever you can't trade players with these intense contracts like Andre Drummond, most of the time teams are like, look, we just can't pay you anymore. Let's just pay you off. We're going to buy out the remainder of your contract and you can sign wherever you want. And that's also to like avoid luxury taxes and get themselves under like the cap space. Mm-hmm. That's when salary cap comes involved, Foo. Since they weren't able to trade him, his asking price was too much for the Cavs just said, look, just going to buy you out, man. Like, there's no point in wasting your talent because you're a talented guy, but you're going to waste your talent here for the remainder of the year. And I think he had like one or two more years left on his contract where he was making like $25 million a year. And they're just like, yeah, nah, we're not doing that. just go do what you got to do, man.
Right.
And that same similar scenario happened with Blake Griffin of the Detroit Pistons. Now Blake Griffin's on the Brooklyn Nets,
yep,
along with KD, James Harden, and Kyrie. And then now LaMarcus Aldridge from the San Antonio Spurs was recently bought out as well. And he signed with the Brooklyn Nets. So the Brooklyn Nets alone now, they have like 50-plus all-star appearances amongst just five of their, like spread out amongst five of their players.
Damn.
Like they're, and it's funny because there's a guy on Instagram. He always posts these funny videos of impersonating LeBron. And so he's like stretching and then it's one of his friends saying, hey, Bron, yo, you hear LA? LaMarcus Aldridge got bought out. He's just like, ah, oh, it's fine, man. It's fine. He's just like, oh, it's cool, man. LaMarcus Aldridge ain't no big. He signed with the Nets. He's like, LaMarcus Aldridge signed with the Nets? Oh, that's okay. It's okay, man. It's cool. I ain't worried about it. And he's like, well, you know, Blake Griffin's dunking again now. He's like, what? Blake Griffin's dunking again? Come on. He's like, I'm 36, man. I'm 36. And he just goes in this full time. It's funny, man. You guys got to watch it if you haven't seen it already. But yeah, man, you got all these young guys coming after a 36-year-old like that. It's like, come on. LeBron's like, yo, why you guys got to come at me like that, bro? But it's basketball's ramping up, man. The season won't end until like late May. This is the first time it's gone on this long. But the transactions alone make it exciting. And I think that's what makes sports exciting nowadays is the way that these players and teams conduct transactions and free agency. Because, players can go anywhere now. like you can have super teams in any sport, and that's what's crazy.
That's the whole intro to basketball of what was wrong with sports. You know, people weren't loyal to the city that they grew up in or around in. So they just go anywhere they want as long as the money is there.
A basketball reference.
Foo, the Utah Jazz moved from New Orleans to Salt Lake where jazz is banned.
Yeah.
I mean, Foo, how does that make sense?
It's almost a bad word there.
they weren't thinking, obviously, Foo. Nope, but yeah, man, more news to come with the Lakers because they still have the ability to sign one more player. So they may sign Avery Bradley, who was on the team last year. And he may come back. He was actually a great defender. And he's actually being bought out by the Miami Heat. So, Foo, the buyout market's alive and well right now. And one last thing I want to talk about in sports, Foo, is the NFL. We actually have the college pro days right now. That's mainly been what's been going on, and free agency. And during these right during this time, usually teams only send out their scouts. There's not many transactions done besides, you know, signings. There's no trades. Mm-hmm. Well, the Miami Dolphins said, fuck that, yo. Let's start ramping up some shit. Let's start ruffling some feathers.
The Dolphins.
So the Dolphins had the number 3 pick. They had two first-round picks this year because the Houston Texans were just morons and decided, hey, let's trade away all of our assets, you know, because we'll be good. Mm. Nope. The Dolphins had the number 3 pick because of Houston. That was supposed to be Houston's pick. Mm-hmm. And they traded the number 3 pick to the San Francisco 49ers for the number 12 pick, two future first round picks, and a second round pick, I believe, in this year's draft. And the Dolphins sent like a third and first. Mm-hmm. So the Niners jumped all the way up to number 3 now. So now the Niners are at number 3 and are ripe and ready to get one of these top 3 quarterbacks that really? Were projected to go. Yeah, so the Niners are trying to be good again. And the Dolphins are just stacking up more picks. So, Foo, did you think that that was it for the Dolphins? Well, you're wrong. You're wrong, Foo.
You got to give me time to guess.
No, Foo, no. Okay. You don't get no time to guess. All right. Because you don't know nothing. The Dolphins decided that's not enough. Let's jump right back in. And they traded the number 12 pick, another future first round pick for next year's draft, and a third or fourth round pick in this year's draft to the Philadelphia Eagles for the 6th pick and the 158th pick. Foo, I was upset because I'm like, yo, Eagles, what the fuck, man? We had a good pick. And you guys are just bitches. You don't know. You're scared you're going to make a mistake. But Dolphins said, man.
They've done it before.
Yeah, telling me. You're telling me, bro. The number 12 pick is a really tough pick to do because the drop-off in talent from the first 10 picks or so is immense. Like, you can have, like, a stud in the first 10, and then, like, the next 3 are just shit. And that's kind of what happened to the Eagles for like the last few years. When we pick in that range, is that our GM just sucks and doesn't know what he's fucking picking, and ends up picking overrated players. So I'm not looking forward to the new overrated player we're gonna have at the end of this year's draft. Let me just say. And
Well, if you're upset, I'm happy, man. So.
See, Foo, I knew you'd be happy about that, and that's why I brought it up, Foo, because my misery brings happiness.
Yeah.
R.I.P. Eagles.
R.I.P.
R.I.P. R.I.P. Hey, man, I got my one championship. That's enough. I guess that's enough for me.
That's all you get, man.
That's all I get, man. That's all I get. That's all the football god said. Like, all right, Josh, you get one. Everyone gets one. It's like Spider-Man. Everyone gets one.
I mean, is it fair to call that a fluke, or was that a legit champion?
No, man, that was a legit champion, I believe, because throughout that season we were actually really good.
Pretty dominant,
and we were pretty dominant that entire season. And when we lost our starting QB, no one thought that we were gonna be able to last. But I mean, I think that team was a solid team. Like, that's. For me, it felt like when remember when the Bucks won their first champion and they had Warren Sapp, Derek Brooks, John Lynch, and Keyshawn Johnson. Mm-hmm. It felt kind of like that, where it's like it was just a great team win, a championship. But our organizations just always got to shoot themselves in the foot, man.
They're Philadelphians.
I mean, Foo, it's like we see a nice shiny gun, and instead of keeping the safety off, we like to keeping the safety on. We like to keep it off and point it in our eye or point it at our feet and have a misfire every once
in
a while.
It's that meme. I don't know if you've seen it recently, but usually, it's taken on like a life of itself, this meme. But it's when a father gives his son like a couple bucks and he's like, now spend this wisely. And in the next panel, you see the little kid at the next vending machine that says like cocaine and putas.
That's the Eagles. All right. That's
the Eagles right there.
Oh yeah, man. And then we get mad that we were given that much money in the first place to make that mistake. Why did you let us make that mistake?
You knew.
Why'd you let me do it?
Exactly.
This is your fault for letting me do this.
Yeah, you knew how I get when I drink.
Yeah, you have no one else to blame but yourself, sir. Yeah, now I'm going to go binge on some Coke and beer.
You knew what this your was. Fault. Bring on the Coke and putas.
Saca la bolsita.
That's right. Saca, homie.
Anyway. All right. Well, Foo, that's it for me in sports and such.
All right, cool. Everybody stick around for music highlights right after this. The music highlights is brought to us by Pony Throat Spray, the best throat spray when you're a little hoarse. So, Foos.
Fuck you, man. No. You think I'm just going to let that one slide? Fuck you.
Hey, all right. Hey. Dude, relax.
Fuck you.
Well, in lieu of not having an actual musical guest today, I thought fast. And, you know, yesterday being Saturday, March 27th, as we record this, our friends over at Soaring Blackbirds, they put out a new music video. I don't know if you've had a chance to check that out, Josh, for their song. Blues Machine. Now, the last time that we had the Soaring Blackbirds on the Foo Bar show was like in the, what, like episode 202 or something like that.
And I don't know, man. I was really drunk for
we
that
We were
episode.
All drunk, Josh. They brought this big-ass bottle of tequila. We took shot. Oh, dude, we teared it up.
Oh, yeah.
But
you tore it up.
Shut up. tore it up. But, you know, we ended up, we did play this song, but I wanted for everybody listening and watching us online on our socials. By the way, you can watch us. You can watch the, I don't know why you would, but you can watch us on Facebook,
yeah, we're not anything
Instagram, Twitch, Facebook, YouTube. You can watch us if you want to. And I'm going to go ahead and play this music video by their song, Blues Machine. Here we go.
Broken man with that enough time, realizing what he's never gonna be. A southern man, a broken
That was Blues Machine by the Soaring Blackbirds, man. That's a hell of a track, dude. I've grown to like that one quite a bit, and I don't know if you've had a chance to check out the music video yet, but if you haven't, go ahead and check that out. I like that all of the significant others for the band members have a part in the music video, mm-hmm. Steph, right? They're all wearing like a crow's head, like mask thing. Oh, and they're all a Soaring Blackbird, but
oh yeah.
But it's funny. It's funny and endearing in a way. Like, I really enjoyed the direction that they took for this music video because it shows them being, you know, dads or being like older gentlemen with their wife and kids and trying to live a life. But at the same time, they're a broken down blues machine. So they still want to go out there and rock your face off, which they do. Mm-hmm. If you guys haven't had a chance to check out the Soaring Blackbirds music and hopefully soon a lot of shows coming up when everything starts opening up. I suggest you do, man. And they might end up playing a lot with the Fallen Electric because we're antsy, man. We want to get back out there. But I get my shot tomorrow, probably just like you, Josh. Get my first Pfizer shot. And you know, once we get chipped, we can also communicate through it, too, I heard.
That's right.
Yes.
We just have to tap our shoulder, and then, you know, you can hear whatever message I'm sending. So we can thank Bill Gates for that.
You know, when you guys get your first shot, it's going to be just like that South Park vaccination special when the old people were just like, fuck you guys. Yeah. They're all like super excited. They're all walking around, just dancing. Just
trolling everybody.
Yep. It's going to be just like that.
Nice. Well, up next, I wanted to play not a new song, but it's a new music video that the Cooties came out with. I don't know if you guys remember me playing the Cooties recently, but they have a new music video for their song called Plaza. And it's pretty funny. It's a cool little song. Check it out.
One, two, one, two, three. Every town in the USA is changing. Gas stations have TVs and Uber's killing the taxi.
And everywhere you look, there's an ATM. Yeah. A fancy, fancy coffee shop. A California pizza kitchen right next to a Starbucks.
They're practically connected.
'Cause everything's a plaza.
Welcome to the plaza.
Welcome to the plaza.
Before that, it was a park.
The Red Bull truck just pulled up. A buff guy in a tank top is handing out samples of Red Bull outside the vape shop,
which is right next to a GameStop.
'Cause they're practically connected.
'Cause everything's a plaza. Welcome to the plaza.
Welcome to the plaza.
The Cooties, man. They're a really fun band to watch and listen to because they always just talk about some dumb shit like Welcome to the Plaza.
I mean, Foo, welcome to the plaza, Foo.
Yeah, everything's a plaza. Everything.
Literally.
Yep. Whoa. These days.
But not really because everything is a drum.
Everything's a drum.
Mm-hmm.
That's true. Damn you.
It's true. Well, anyway, last but not least, in the grand old spirit of this week in music history, back in 1974, Delta blues singer and guitarist Arthur Big Boy Crudup died of a stroke at age 69. He wrote That's All Right, Mama, covered by Elvis Presley, which is really what made Elvis Presley famous or put him on the map as a legitimate artist when he went in and recorded this for his mom. I believe it might have either been his mom's birthday or Mother's Day that he covered this song, That's All Right, by Arthur Crudup. Check it out.
Thank you. right for you. That's all right, no mama. Any way you do, but that's all right. That's all right. That's all right now, mama. Any way you do. Well, my mama, she done told me. Papa told me too. The life you live in, son, now women be the death for you. But that's all right. That's all right. That's all right now, mama. Any way you do. Yeah, man.
Have you guys heard the Elvis Presley version? It's a lot more cleaned up, obviously, but
yeah,
you know, this is old school blues.
I like the old school blues, though, Foo. Blues is where it's at.
Yeah, man.
It's nice.
No, well, that's going to do it for the music highlights. Everybody stick around for the Foo Facts. All right, Foo. Well, the Foo Facts is brought to us by Sharon is Karen, the new best-selling instructional book on how to creatively ask to speak to a manager. Even if you're a Sharon,
stupid,
you
could
still
Karen.
Be a Karen. Well, anyways, now you were gonna do three. I was gonna do three. You want to go first? Maybe I can go second, and you go third. You know what I mean?
Yeah, Foo. I see what you're doing.
See what I did there? All right,
turns.
Cool. You
want to
take turns?
So, first Foo fact, Foo. Did you know that there's a company that turns dead bodies into an ocean reef?
Oh.
Foo fact.
What's that all about?
So for those who romanticize a burial at sea, the company Eternal Reefs offers an innovative solution. It mixes the cremated remains of a person with concrete to create a pearl onto which loved ones can etch personal messages, handprints, or environmental friendly mementos. The pearl is then encased in a reef ball that is dropped into the ocean, where it provides a new habitat for fish and other sea life, helping encourage a vibrant ecosystem.
That's nice.
Seafood, the circle of life at work.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's see here. More human twins are now being born more than ever before. So what they're saying here is that, do you get the feeling that there are more twins around these days than there used to be? No?
It's quite unsettling.
Well, you should, because according to the twinning rate, it's increased by 1/3 since the 80s, up from 9 to 12 twins per 1,000 deliveries. Currently, that adds about 1.6 million twins born each year across the world, meaning that one out of every 42 babies is a twin. So, and I think it has to do a lot with people doing in vitro and maybe taking some fertility pills. You know, that usually you end up getting more than one kid from that. So,
yeah, I was going to suggest such a thing, Foo. Jeez. And Foo, we missed that on our spare body parts, Foo. We don't got no twins.
I know. What was that movie? The Island or something?
The Island.
Was it?
Yeah, I think it was. Yes.
With Scarlett Johansson?
I think it was. Yeah, and Ewan McGregor?
Yeah, and what's his name? Wasn't he Debo? What's his name? The actor who played Debo. He was one of the... Anyway.
Tiny Terry Crews?
No. What?
Tiny Lister? Tiny Lister Jr.?
That sounds oddly correct. But anyway, moving on.
All right, Foo. Try this one on for thoughts.
All right.
You can buy a flying bicycle, Foo.
Is it like that Da Vinci one where you have to pedal and it has that stupid fucking parachute above you? Or
no, Foo, but I like where your mind's at.
Okay.
Now, Foo, if it sounds like something out of sci-fi novel, but British inventor John Foden and Yannick Reid have come up with a bicycle that actually flies. The Explore Air Paravelo is composed of a folding bicycle and a lightweight trailer that contains a biofuel-powered fan motor. The motor turns the fan with enough of a runway, it can reach up to 25 miles per hour in the air.
Damn.
And 4,000 feet in altitude.
What the fuck?
Yeah, while the inventors were unable to reach their funding goal to produce enough Explore Airs for wide availability, they are offering their inventive services through the Bespoke production. And I think Bespoke is where you can build your own custom bike. Mm. So if you're looking for a flying motorcycle, Foo, just go to, you know, Bespoke and get yourself some flying motorcycles and such.
Interesting. All right. I'm on it. No, I'm not on it. Let's see here. The first person convicted of speeding was going 8 miles per hour. According to Guinness World Records, the first person to be charged with speeding was Walter Arnold of the English village of Paddock Wood, Kent, on January 28th, 1896. Arnold was spotted going four times the speed limit in his 19th century Benz. But since the speed limit at the time was just 2 miles per hour, that meant he was not going too fast by today's standards, obviously.
That's, wow.
How much do you think the ticket cost?
Let's see, Foo, if we're thinking about the, you know,
1896
inflation, it's 1896. I say, Foo, that ticket was a $5 ticket.
Well, Foo,
and that was expensive.
The constable had to chase him down on his bicycle. and he issued a ticket for £4, earning Arnold the speedy distinction. For more trivia, keep following this. Oh, yeah, that's all it is. Anyway.
What's the exchange rate on that, Foo?
What, 20 bucks?
Who knows?
Would it be like 20, anywhere between 20 and 50 bucks?
That's probably kinda like a $205 to $500 speeding ticket. It's in pounds.
For the time, Foo? Yeah, that's true. Yeah. That is true.
2 miles an hour? That's less
than... That's the speed limit.
You can run faster than that.
You can. That's fucking dumb.
Obviously, this constable couldn't because, you know, they fell in.
You got to get on a bike.
Yeah. All right, Foo. Here's my last doozy here. Mm-hmm. Did you know that Alfred Hitchcock was frightened of eggs?
What? How so?
So the master of suspense who terrified audiences with the movies like Psycho and The Birds considered himself an ovophobe, someone frightened of eggs. Alfred Hitchcock explained in an interview in 1963, "I'm frightened of eggs. Worse than frightened, they revolt me. That white round thing without holes, and when you break it inside, there's that yellow thing, round without any holes. Blood is jolly red." He's like, "Blood is jolly red, but egg yolk is yellow, revolting. I never tasted it."
Huh. Well, he's missing out.
Well, is he, Foo?
I like a good egg. It's all I could eat these days anyway.
He looked like an egg too.
Irony, right?
Yeah.
He did make the movie Birds, Foo.
Birds.
Yeah.
Birds.
Yeah, there you go. All right. Well, lastly, let's see. I got the last Foo fact here. So many feet bones don't harden until you're an adult.
Foo fact.
So each foot contains 26 bones as well as 33 joints and 19 muscles, which work together for all kinds of motion and movements. But many of these bones remain cartilage throughout childhood, and then they slowly ossify into bone as the years goes on. So they don't completely harden for a person until you're like around 21 years old. Go fucking figure. Huh. Have you ever broken a foot or anything?
Broken an ankle.
Yeah, boom. There you go.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Time to take off the legs.
That's it.
Damn it.
Take them out back.
I knew it. Yep. I knew it. Well, Foo, would you like to add a couple of more Foo facts, or do you think that's enough?
You know what? Yeah, if you want to throw in a couple doozies, go for it.
All right, Foo. All right. Well, here, try this one on for size. Mm-hmm. Did you know that for 20 years, a cat served as mayor of an Alaskan town?
I believe.
Foo facts.
I totally believe that.
In 1997, an orange cat named Stubbs became honorary mayor of the Alaskan town of Talkeetna, with a population of 772 people. In 2000, it would not have taken too many voters to earn that position, and the small town did not actually have a real mayor anyway. But Stubbs proved adept at the role, gaining fans from around the world and serving in the position for years, greeting tourists and becoming a beloved symbol of the town until his untimely death in 2017.
Wow, that's so
cat recent. Lived 20 years, Foo.
Yeah, that's not even like, oh, that was like yesteryear. That was like just a few years ago.
I know.
Just a kitty was a mayor. God damn it.
Foo, man, the cats were really trying to take over the world.
See, that's the kind of news that we need.
Right. Did you have the last Foo fact, or you want me to dish one out?
Foo, let's let you dish one out. Let's see what you got.
So we got this one here. Pigeons can tell the difference between a painting by Monet and Picasso. In a 1995 study published by the Journal of Experimental Analysis and Behavior, researchers reported being able to train pigeons to discriminate between paintings by Monet and Picasso when shown slides of their works that they had previously never seen before. When the Picasso images were inverted, the little art connoisseurs could still tell it was a Picasso. Maybe that's why they like landing on statues so much.
Foo, they appreciate good art. Yeah. They have a keen eye for art, Foo.
That's right. Well, is that going to do it for Foo Facts, man?
Yeah, Foo. I think we'll leave it off with that one there.
All right, cool, man. Cool. Well, you know, we'll see if Hope wants to join us next week.
I have no hope, Foo. I have no hope for that.
I think we've kind of let go of hope there.
Yes, Foo.
No pun intended at all. Like, at all.
Actually, but I did, though. But yeah. Anyway.
Well, I don't know. What else do we have to look forward to? We got, like we said in Geeking Out, we got Godzilla versus Kong coming out. We're going to discuss the shit out of that one next week.
Yes. Oh, hell yeah, Foo. Would that be a Podzilla?
Without the Foo? Is it possible? Sans Can it be
Foo?
Done?
I mean, Foo.
Can we call it an emergency? Really,
I mean, Foo, we can call it an emergency, Foo, because I'm sure the Foo's watching that movie.
You know he is. Kinda...
There's no way he's not.
He's going to be texting us while as he's watching it.
Just spoiling everything.
Did you?
It'll
see
be TBD,
that?
Foo. I will consult with the Foo on the side and see if he wants to relinquish control for one episode. But we'll see.
Okay.
We'll see, Foo.
All right. Otherwise, it's happening. I'm just going to say that right
now. All right, yeah.
It's still fucking happening. Because we talked about it in a previous episode where once this movie came out, we were going to dedicate an episode or at least a whole segment to it. So,
see, Foo, we made sure to finish off the Toa era, the Showa era, in time to watch this movie. So right. I'm excited, man. I cannot wait. We've seen nothing but new trailers with the emergence of Mechagodzilla. That Mechagodzilla trailer looked dope as all heck. Mm-hmm. And that's dope that they finally confirmed it. So, Foo, we got that. And then we have
The Chinese trailer pretty much just gave it away that we're going to get a Mechagodzilla. And you were saying Mortal Kombat?
Oh, yeah, Mortal Kombat. We'll probably get a couple of new trailers for Mortal Kombat in the next couple of weeks. Mm-hmm. Maybe even a new Red Band trailer.
Hell yeah.
Which again... So far, that just looks like it's going to be amazing and everything I dreamed of. Mm-hmm. Foo, more Falcon and Winter Soldier and such.
Right. And probably more sports stuff, right?
Yes, Foo, yes. We will have probably continue to monitor the March Madness. I will say who's in the Elite Eight and who's moving on potentially to the Final Four. And then, well, let's just have a small little prediction. Hopefully the Foo can jump on for that one and... we can get some final predictions for the tournament and definitely be wrong, because that's all we ever are on the FUBAR show.
Yep.
We're wrong.
People too. Count on us on
being wrong.
Yeah. That's the appeal.
That's the appeal. We're not spoiling anything once you think about it.
That's true. That is true, Foo. I mean, everyone just tunes in to see what we're wrong about this week.
Yep. That's what it really
Stay
is
Stay tuned.
Yep.
Stay tuned, Foos.
Well, like I said earlier, check out the video form of this podcast on Facebook, YouTube, Twitch, Instagram. Post all kinds of stuff like that throughout the week. And, man, to send us a couple of shillings, man. We got a PayPal. We got a Venmo at FUBAR Show. So send us a buck or two. Help us out. You know, the more we can grow, the more we can, I don't know if you guys have seen, but Filthy Martini Entertainment is up on Facebook. And, hey, we might end up adding more content on there if there's more podcasts that want to jump on board and be a part of Filthy Martini Entertainment. So we'll see how that progresses as we go. There's really no plan as of yet, but we'll see what happens. But anywho, Foos. Thank you all very much for listening into the FUBAR Show. Thanks for hitting subscribe. And remember to rate, review, and tell your friends like a fucking champion. You can always reach us and check out our merch at FUBARshow.com. That's FOOBARshow.com. And search FOOBARshow on YouTube, Twitch, Twitter, and Instagram. Check us out. Drop us a line and we'll foo it up like a couple of foos. I've been Josie.
I've been Josh.
And Steph.
Signing off, saying... Don't be-